Greetings and welcome in a gear review with a Frenchman. I just finished the HexaTrek a few weeks ago. It's 3,000 kilometers to cross France in its entirety, starting from Les Vosges and going to Hendaye and crossing, well, almost every mountain you can think of, every mountain range. This is kind of a tradition. I'm going to work on a documentary about this trek. But because it's a fairly new trek, I mean, you cannot make more new than a brand new trek that nobody has hiked before. So I thought maybe you might be interested in a video review of my pack. This pack is right there. So I'm going to go across all of my backpack and what do I have on it. What gear worked, what gear didn't work, and yeah, it's a gear review video. What else can you expect? First of all, the pack itself. This is an Atmos pack from Osprey. This is a very classical pack, and this is the kind of pack that has very nice frame, very ventilated, although the ventilation didn't really cut it for me, but it is a framed backpack. It's quite on the heavy side. I like it. It's not the pack I did my entire trek with. It's actually the second pack I had. This pack, I changed it 500 kilometers before the end. So I hacked most of it with the Elementum X pack from Liteway. It's a Ukrainian based company. And I actually did another trek with one of their packs, loved it, and I did it again. Only problem is it's an ultralight backpack. So if you have more than 12 kilos, that's not really nice, because you have absolutely no frame, you have no weight thingies there. Yeah, I'm not very technical. And it's not the easiest way to use a backpack, to be fair. So I changed to this one that I didn't really choose. It was the backpack of my grandfather that he never got to use, sadly. Not a drastic change, in the sense that I was so used to the other one that it was fine. But I noticed that this one could stay on my back way longer. It's heavier, but the frame and everything made it way more practical, actually. So if I had to go back on the trek one day, I would probably go with not exactly this one, but maybe another one with a frame, because it really helps. It just helps. It's just nice. And Osprey build quality is amazing, so I have absolutely no complaints about it. Very nice pack, very well organized. This is my beloved seat pad from Thermarest. This seat pad has been with me since my first hike on the Via Adriatica. It was 2 years ago and I did 1,000 kilometers. I'm going to talk about this a lot because most of the equipment I have actually is equipment I used already from a previous hike. So this one that is beat up in every possible way. It's a fantastic little thing. It weighs nothing, allows you to sit on almost anything, especially on wet days, and you just feel good on it. Very nice thing. I could buy a new one, but it's still working. I have it here, the water bottle. This is just like a classic water bottle you could find anywhere, especially in France. This is a Volvic bottle, but it doesn't change. Just make sure to take like this kind of screw on tap and not the pop open ones, because, well, they degrade faster. And don't forget to change them from time to time, because this gets smelly. Actually, I should change that one. I should throw it away. And you could actually poison yourself with it, like it happened to another HexaTrekker that I walked with a little bit. So yeah, make sure to change those ones from time to time. The poles. Still have the same poles from my previous hikes. Those poles are the Hyper Strong Super Light Micro Vario Ty Evo from Leki. Love those poles. Very, very efficient poles. What I like about them is that, first of all, you can fold them, take no space, and they are very easy to take in and out. And I've done the entire Via Adriatica, plus a bit of the Geo 10, plus the entire HexaTrek. So they have 4,200 kilometers. And they're still working. They are a little bit bent. The right one, this one, is a bit bent because I fell a few times in the mountains and could catch my fall actually with those. But it bent them. But because they're made out of metal, they bend and they don't break, which is nice. Also, those lanyards, they both gave up on two different ways. And maybe like 200 kilometers before the end. So at the very end, actually, they started to give up. You're going to see a mess accumulating there. So get ready for that. My camp shoes. These are the Astral something. It would be written anyway. Those shoes performed exactly like you want to. These are flip-flops with a twist because they have this little lanyard that allows them to really stick to your foot, and they are made to actually walk on wet stones. So it's very practical actually whenever you have to get water from your for your camp or stuff like that. Those ones really get the job done. I love those, and I still use them now. Very sturdy, they don't look destroyed like my previous ones, and you can walk actually several kilometers in them without blisters, which is nice. Love those ones. Front pocket, front mesh pocket. Basically everything I have is kind of the same way as I had in my previous pack. I just had to adapt a few things because they're not exactly made the same way, but roughly. This is my Arc'teryx Zeta SL rain jacket. It's Arc'teryx. It's very good quality material. I like Arc'teryx products, to be fair. This one, I didn't get to use it that much. This year was quite particular in France in terms of weather, and I guess everywhere in the world, but because I was on my trek, I didn't check anything else. We had heat wave after heat wave, so it was a very, very warm year, which means as well that it was very dry. It was one of the driest year we had ever, so I didn't get to use that a lot. I used it technically two times before the last week. In 4.5 months, I had 2 days of rain. So I didn't get to test it a lot in the rain, but then in the wind, it worked flawlessly, it worked amazingly. Also when it was a tiny bit chilly, but you're walking, so you don't want to overheat. Fantastic quality, extremely lightweight, and it doesn't feel lightweight like my previous one. It feels lightweight, but that can take a beating. You're not afraid when there are thorns or something like that that could poke it. The material feels very resistant. I absolutely love this thing. It's insanely pricey, but it's a good one. Thank you for keeping me dry. This, my everything bag. In this bag from Liteway, actually, X-Pack, this is kind of my pharmacy slash, I don't really know actually. Got a tiny bit of toothpaste. I got 10 meters of Dynamite cord that I didn't get to use except once. I got a very old condom that I should never use because it's been there forever. I don't even know when I put it there. I have needles that I had to change. I had my swing kit. Actually, you see a bit of my swing kit. I sewed a lot on this trip, and this is useful for blisters. This is useful for clothes. This is useful for everything. Toothbrush. Because this was on the outside of my pack, it also got rained on heavily on the last week, because the last week was very rainy. I have miscellaneous. This is ibuprofen. I got the Falgon. I got a ton of others. Some pads with alcohol that are completely dry, and I should definitely... I didn't open that one before the video. What's it called? Picking thingy? There is a name for that, right? This is useful for any thorn you can have in your body, or also ticks. Tons of ticks in France. I didn't get any problem with the ticks in my entire life, despite the fact that it was a tick infestation. I just had 2 ticks on the very last day. That was crazy. I never had one in my life, and then I saw 2 on me, so that was funny. Use that to take it out, no problem. Something to cut your nails. This is my Pierre d'Alain. It's alum stone, not sure in English. This is a natural deodorant that I used every time I had a shower, which was very rare. And you have some rolls of thread to go with the needles, some more rolls, and a bunch of horrible stuff in the bottom that I don't want to touch. Continuing, bladder and my water filter. Most of the water sources in France are very good because it's France, so it's not infected by a lot of things, and there are no heavy industries polluting the waters and everything. It's pretty fine. I'm using this filter by Platypus. I used a Sawyer before, but I used a Sawyer Mini. It was not enough for my needs in terms of water flow. This one, the water flow is really, really good. The only down is that it gets clogged with time, and I didn't find the process to clean it so easy. It comes along with this, so you put the dirty water in, screw this on, and then you have clean water. This got some holes at the very end of the trip, but it didn't fill before that, so quite a resistant pouch. You can screw this on plastic bottles as well, but yeah, didn't use it like that. Use it with the design pouch, and I'm actually quite glad. It worked really well to access some water sources that were a bit hard. I tried to use it every time I was using a water source from the mountains, or not from a tap, and that prevented me a ton of problems. So really happy about this one. This is a box of little cigars, because yes, I am a smoker whenever I have a drink, and I had quite a few of those. My little towel is a Zeta Summit towel, nothing fancy to say about that. It's a microfiber towel, it's not big, it's very useful. Next, my pooping kit. My pooping kit didn't change since my first thru-hike. I still have the Vargo Titanium DigDig to create the holes. Didn't use it that much because actually in France you stumble upon a lot of villages and a lot of refugees. So you have a lot of access to the bathroom, so didn't have to shit in the woods that much. Still, used it quite a few times. Some biological soap to go along with that, so you can use with the next item that you cannot see because I lost it a few days before the end of my trip. It's actually the Culo Clean bidet. So I'm using a water solution. I'm not using toilet paper. I talked a little bit more about my bidet in my previous video, but basically, yes, you spray water on your ass to get rid of the remains, and then you can actually clean yourself, which is a very nice solution because it keeps you really clean. The only downside to that is that when you go to a campsite that don't have toilet paper, this is not an easy solution to use on regular toilets. So when you have only regular toilets but no toilet paper to use with it, it's kind of annoying. Some patches. As you know, I was hiking the HexaTrek, and as you can see here, as you can see on the front of my backpack, I was also advertising for it, and those ones I was keeping them to give to other HexaTrekkers that didn't have the chance to have one and wanted to have a patch so that they can recognize each other whenever they cross paths. This is a little tube of Vaseline that I made. Didn't use it that much, but it's very nice whenever you have something rubbing a little bit too much. Put some Vaseline on it. If your feet are starting to feel a little bit too cloggy, you put some Vaseline on it. If you get sunburn, you put some Vaseline on it. Basically anything that kind of hurts, you put Vaseline on it. It's really good, and it helps with the healing process. Really like this stuff. My Vargo Flask Titanium. There's no word to say how much I love this thing. I kept in this my Rakija. Rakija is a Croatian alcohol that is traditionally being made by families, and I take this one from Branko, father of Maria. This is basically the family that gave me my supply of Rakija for the entire trip. Rakija is an alcohol that you traditionally drink when you are Croatian on hikes all the time, and because my first hike was in Croatia, I kept this as a habit. It's very nice to have a little bit of humph whenever it gets too cold at night before sleeping, or when you have like a long day that was a bit tough. And this Rakija tastes like an adult candy. It's not very strong, but it warms you up. It absolutely adore it, absolutely a luxury item. Sponsored by Rakija. Continuing, the big stuff. This is my tent. This is the Zpacks Duplex in camo version. And it is probably one of the most famous tent for thru-hikers. Whenever you like gear, this thing come out quite a lot. But as you can see, this is just the pouch. The pouch is destroyed. The pouch doesn't look like nothing. I had this tent for 2 years now. I love it. I absolutely love it. I think it's the best damn tent possible. You cannot find a better tent. I know that everybody that has a tent say that for the tent, but I will say that for mine. This thing is magical. It's very light. It's insanely big. But it's also at the end of its life. I used it on the Viadriatica, I used it on the GR10, I used it on some other nights outside of treks, and I used it for the entire HexaTrek. it has holes. It now has holes. Not a lot of them, nothing that would make water get in. The ground is completely holey, so you cannot put this tent anywhere that is already moist. And I mean, it's killing me a little bit because I love it. I love it in this color. I would not change it for another tent. I would take the exact same one or the XL version they have now. But you have to know that this tent is not made forever. It will get destroyed. It will get destroyed. There is some tape that I'm using here that is helping, but in general, this tent will get destroyed. It's still working. I love it to bits. I'm using those ridiculously big and efficient tent pegs. That's all weighing almost the weight of the tent, but I don't care. Those are two versions. I have this long titanium nail ones that are already overkill, and because I made a mistake, I ordered those insanely bigger version that weigh a ton. Those things can be hammered in any kind of soil. They are handmade by Herringbur. This is a guy who makes tent pegs. This is the only thing. He only makes tent pegs. So he makes good tent pegs. This one has a little hook, not very useful. To be fair, this one is really enough. It's not that it will last you a lifetime, is that I don't see how they can fail. I really don't see. I was hammering them in the rock and it was perforating the rock. Perforating? Perforating. I have a few stickers of the HexaTrek that I was using on places where I could not put some signs, but that's very specific to me because I have to work, basically. I got this ground sheet, again, 500 kilometers before the end, when I changed for the backpack. This is the ground sheet of somebody else, another hiker, thank you very much, Verna, that used it for a long time. And this ground sheet is made out of Tyvek, and it's a material that is very, very resistant, insanely lightweight, and it's just an added protection. To be fair, I didn't really need it. I used it because I had lakes of water in my tent every night, and it was annoying, but I discovered that those lakes were not created because of the holes in the ground sheet, but because the way the duplex is set up, if you push a little bit too much on the sides, then you have the gutters that will make an inward angle instead of a downward angle. And the water of condensation and every water that is being taken on those seams will run down and create a pool inside of your tent. And I had a ton of problems of pool in my tent that I never had before this trek. On my previous trek, I never had that. On my previous use of this tent, I never had that. So I thought I would change things, but it's also very useful when you sleep in somewhere sketchy, like those cabins that look disgusting, because at least you can put something under your mattress and you feel a little bit safer. I would buy a new one if I do another trek, but yeah, I thought it would be just like luxury, but it's actually quite nice. Yes, I have this little bad boy. The camera I'm using right now is the camera I was actually carrying the entire trek. This camera is the Sony A7C. I cannot show it to you because it's filming me, but I will show it to you in later clips. Sony A7C is an amazing camera. You have to know that I know nothing about cameras. I was a camera virgin, or almost, before this trek. I didn't know much. I picked it up because I knew it would give a professional look and I knew it was quite small and it's perfect for filming. The autofocus is really nice, and when you film yourself you want to make sure that everything is in focus, which is not always the case, let's be honest, even with this feature, because I ruined a ton of shots. And it was hanging here. I'm using also a 20mm lens that is the only lens I was using on the entire trip. On top of that you have a microphone. This microphone is the Rode VideoMic NTG. Amazing microphone. It can do everything. I was recording my podcast every night with it, and I was also filming everything with it. Only problem is that it broke a few times. It broke a few times, and the jack thingy doesn't work as it should. I have mono instead of stereo and stuff like that, so it's not great, but I just love the thing. The sound quality is amazing. And everything was mounted on one thing that I was clipsing on this pick design pick clip. This is like the gold standard in the industry. Everybody's using that, and there is a reason to it. This thing is bulletproof. I had this 1.2 or 3 kilograms thing hanging constantly even when I was passing boulders, rocks, whatever, even when I fell a few times, this thing didn't give up. I felt insanely secured, and there is this nice sound whenever it clicks. And when you hear this click, you know that nobody can take it out of you. It's amazing. It's really, really secured. I love it. On the other side, I had my tripod, the tripod I'm actually using now. That is not great. It's a Petco tripod. It's very lightweight. It's fully made out of plastic. It's just not stable. It's kind of stable here, but if there is wind, it's going to move. And on top of that, it's breaking so easily. I had to fix it with, basically, there is a screw, an actual screw that I had to screw to fix the plastic holding the thing together. It has no holding power not anymore, so if I put it somewhere, the camera tends to go down. It was a real letdown. I was using quite a lot at the beginning. That's why I had it here, so I can just quickly take it out, put the camera on top, and set it up. But I ended up never using it anymore and just putting my camera on rocks or trees or whatever. So that's kind of a letdown, and I could not change it, and I don't really see another contestant for it. I just loved it when it worked. And it has a feature that you can put it on any tree or tubular object, and it holds the camera really well, and that gives very nice angles. So if it worked all the way to the end, it would have been amazing. To protect this camera, that is always there, I have this very fancy thing, a shower cap for, I guess, people with a lot of hair, a lot of volume, which I don't have anymore. This thing, I picked it up on Amazon. It cost nothing, and the good thing is I could wrap my entire camera and the microphone and everything in it, cinch it, and basically protect it from the rain. It has a few holes, so at the very end of my hike, it didn't work as well, but I spent an entire, I think it was 5 days, walking in the rain. And the camera survived, and the microphone survived. So it worked. It's a good solution. It's a solution, I like it. It has flamingos on it, so it shows people that I am a funny person, or stuck in the 80s. Those are the same gloves I had on the Via Adriatica. These are the least technical gloves ever. These are just thermic gloves. Cost nothing, does exactly what you want, which is protects you from the cold. You have cold hands, you put them on, they're very thin, they're very efficient. Really love those gloves. They're very nice gloves. Business cards for the HexaTrek. Oh yeah, the shell of a 35mm cartridge, and I found also a 5.56 cartridge somewhere in France. Pen and the tiniest sunscreen ever. I used quite a lot of sunscreen because it was the heat wave, and most of my hike was actually done by 40 degrees in full sun. That was really, really hard, and sun protection really helped. I have now this beautiful tan, the hiker tan, so it kind of faded a little bit, but I have a good V here. This is insanely well tanned. I am blonde hair there, and everything else is as white as some parts of a panda. On the other pocket, I have the fun stuff, some hydroalcoholic gel. I mean, the hygiene is not great on the trail, so this is nice before eating, and it's also very nice, and thank you William for this, to start your fire. Whenever you have to, you want to have a fire, but it's been raining, or it's a little bit wet, or the conditions are not great, or you lack of small wood to restart it, this thing comes in very handy. You can just pour it, light it on fire, and it just lights anything. This is my buff, my VA buff. This is the Via Adriatica official buff. I don't use buff, really. I'm not a buff guy. I have it just in case I get cold. I didn't get cold, so I almost never used it. But whenever I used it, especially at the beginning of the trail, because yes, at the beginning of the trail, I did shave my head, and I never had shaved hair in my entire life. I've never been bald, so I was cold. I discovered that what bald people feel, it's cold. So I used it to sleep the first night as a beanie, because the other beanie I have is this one, and it's not very practical to sleep in it. So I love this thing, love the Via Adriatica, check it out. This is my Petzl, this is the Arctic Core 450 that I picked up in Chamonix. I had another one before, but it failed me, the battery just ran out was an old model, but still, there was literally no reason it stopped, but it stopped. I couldn't find a replacement battery because it's not made anymore, so I had to pick this one up. What can I say? It's very practical. I actually have no beef with it. I would like it to be more waterproof, just reassure me, but I never had a problem with rain or whatever. This pouch is not rain resistant, and it was raining quite a lot, so it got wet a ton of times. I like the fact that you can, there is only one button, so you cannot really get stupid. And this means that it's locked, and if it's locked, it means that it will not like get accidentally turn on, and then it will run the battery dry. And the beam, the high beam of this, is insanely powerful. I used it a few times whenever you're hiking in the dark and you really don't know where you're going. You put the high beam and the entire mountain just lights up. It's really nice to have a feel of where you are. A few cords. Yeah, this is my pouch, and I think we went around the entire pack. There's nothing left. Okay, let's dive in. The way I arrange my pack is made to maximize capacity, because this is quite a fairly big backpack, but on my previous pack it was a 35 liters, and it's like a Tetris game. It can only fit one way. If you move anything, it doesn't fit anymore. On this one, I could be a little bit more, I don't know, careless, but I kept this military precision and every day doing exactly the same, blah, blah, blah. This is my food bag. It's actually an obsack, and this is insanely empty. I used to have like to the brim, food to the brim, because I'm always scared to not have enough food. Now I just have a few dry packs and I don't know, some milk powder, my titanium spork. Come back to that. But yeah, basically this food pack is not useful. Not useful because the lob sack is made to prevent others of the food inside to get outside and attract animals, but it gets destroyed in 2 days maximum. And I kept it only because I knew there were bears in the Pyrenees and I wanted to have this extra layer of protection, even if it's absolutely unnecessary. Like insanely unnecessary. Nobody has seen one. But you know, I was prepared to walk in bear country, so. But no, it's completely useless. Any plastic bag would work exactly the same. Inside, I have this little bad boy that I really enjoy. This is my my traditional spork. This is something I had all the time, but it got lost slash stolen. I'm looking at you, Leia, you know what you did. And this one is actually quite nice. It's a classical combo, it's titanium, nothing can get wrong with that. In the meantime, I bought another one because I thought I would never see that one because, well, it's hard to order things. So I bought that one. Yes, I have two titanium sporks. And I thought I would not like that one because it's not a spork. But I ended up using that one way more because it's very practical. This is an Optimus titanium thingy. It's very nice to get to the bottom of things. Like, why you feel so bad all the time? Or, why did your mother said that in 88? God, do I love this thing. This is my customized cutting board. It is handmade in Croatia. It is the VA cutting board, so the Viadriatica cutting board, and it's dedicated to me, Lord Pomalo Pishkin. You will not laugh at that, but everybody speaking Croatian now is laughing. Ask them why. Love this thing. I cut all my sausages on it. It's an amazing piece of equipment. I'm so glad I have it, and it went with me on all the adventures. Electronics. I keep my electronics in a waterproof bag because it is in the section of the backpack that can get flooded. I have basically everything arranged so that it can get all wet and anything sensitive should survive. Inside, it's not going to be so flashy, but I have USB-C cable, memory card for the camera, another memory card for the camera, 20,000 battery. This is the HexaTrek family. It's, I don't even know the brand. It will be written somewhere. Somewhere? Somewhere. 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 Just a 20,000. What I really wanted to have is the USB fast charge port so that my phone can charge fast and that you can recharge the battery fast when you're in town. I also have my old 10,000 milliampers battery from Anker that I really like but doesn't have the fast charge. This was my backup plan. I didn't use it, almost. So I didn't really need it. The 20,000 was enough because again, we're in France, there is civilization all the time, you can recharge everything. This is a fancy SD card reader that I wanted for various reasons that didn't work. Another pouch with batteries for the camera, a battery charger, and that's it. That's it. Just a cleaning thingy. Another USB-C cable, always useful. Charger, it's a 65 watts from Ugreen with three plugs. Two USB-C and one USB-A port. Very practical, again, to charge everything at once when you're in the city. And it's a 65 watts, so it means it's super fast to charge. I really like this thing, very light. Another cable, but this one came in handy, but it's not for now. And my Kindle. This is an Amazon Kindle Voyage, the old version, and very, very nice. I mean, you want to have something to do at night at camp. Sometimes you want to read, and it's very nice to have something to read. You've been seeing me like doing this all the time. There are mosquitoes. Ton of mosquitoes, and I'm getting bitten as we talk and through my goddamn pants as well. Let's continue. My Arc'teryx fleece. This is the Atom something, I think. I have this thing for years now. I would say at least five years. I just love this thing. It doesn't want to give up. It's just nice. It's really warm. It's very light. It's gorgeous. It's a very nice color. And I used it on tracks. I used it at home. I use it all the time. This is my go-to fleece and it's a beautiful thing. I love it. Absolutely adore it. This is just gas. That's a gas cartridge. I don't know what to say about that. It's a gas cartridge. Oh, speaking of absolutely useless object that I love, here are my Ren paints. Again, by Arc'teryx. Actually, this was my luxury item, one of my luxury items on the Via Adriatica that I never used because it almost never rained. And guess what? Happened again. I carried this thing all the way. It cost a fortune, like everything Arc'teryx does, and I almost never used it. That being said, absolutely don't regret having it because it was an added protection whenever I needed it. It's something I could wear whenever I was taking care of the laundry because I had nothing else to wear otherwise. And it's just beautiful. It's very practical. Whenever it's raining and I'm using it, it works exactly as you want. I even use it on my motorcycle. And when you ride a motorcycle, usually the rain gets very intense because of the wind, because of the speed and everything. This thing cut everything, and it's very, very light. Love this thing, absolutely don't need it. And you know what? I would bring it again. I would bring it again. I would not go on a hike without it. The Cantina. Tux titanium, classical, very nice, with some suguru for the handles. It goes like this, so you can fry an egg and also cover it. Luxury item. My coffee maker. This is the coffee maker I use at home as well. It's an AeroPress Go. I could talk about that for hours. I just love the AeroPress. Love the coffee it makes, and I refuse to drink instant coffee. I refuse. I'd rather not have coffee. So yeah, I bring my AeroPress, and I everywhere I go, I try to find the local roastery so I can have actual good coffee, and I have all the time. And I love to prepare it. This little titanium cup is the titanium cup for my coffee. Love it. And I use it only for the coffee or for some beverage so that it doesn't spoil the taste. I don't eat out of it. But as you can see, I use it on the fire directly or on the stove. Speaking of the stove, let's talk about the stove. The BRS 300 or 3000T, it's the most classical one. It costs nothing. I have it for two hikes now, so the Via Adriatica and the HexaTrek, and it still works perfectly. I mean, this thing is magical. And got it. A small beak that got little bit bad. But I have two beaks on me always, two lighters, a little scrubby scrub thingy. This is the cantina. Now we're getting into this portion of the bag and we can get rid of the bag. This is a bag liner that I put at the very bottom so that everything that is wet can go above it, and if it drips, it drips on it. It kept my bag completely protected. Really like it. It's the small Sea to Summit liner bag. It's nice. It just survives 3,000 kilometers without problem. I have a little bit of a repair kit here and some bandage that I didn't really use. Oh, something I used quite a lot, my repair kit from Exped. This has a tiny UV light that helps cure the glue in 10 seconds. Very useful because I had a ton of problem with my hair mattress, we'll talk about that, and I had to repair it a million times, pretty much, and this got the job done. Also, some more rope, some tenacious tape that is useless. Absolutely useless if you want to patch holes on a mattress. Practical, not fancy, but gets the job done. My puffy. It was a very warm year, so I didn't get to use my puffy so much. It's a Cumulus Incredilite in black color. Really, really nice. I like that. It looks good. Very light. Whenever you're a tiny bit cold, you put this on and you're warm almost instantly. I even used it when I was in Georgia. It was minus 16, and minus 16 I had the Arc'teryx fleece and this thing on, and I was not warm, but I was okay. Minus 16, you should be fine for any trip coming, and if it gets a little bit too cold at night, you can use various things in this. This is my textile pouch. Oh, I love this, absolutely love this. This is my pillow. It's a Nemo Elite Philo something. This pillow is with me since my first hike. Never had a single issue on it. It is very small. It packs down to nothing. It takes a few seconds to blow it up. And you can take the cover off. And it has a little bit of a thin layer of foam, which makes for the feeling of a real pillow. It doesn't feel like a plastic bag. And if you under-inflate it a little bit, it's possible to sleep for a stomach sleeper. And I am a stomach sleeper, and it was really hard to find, and I found that one. So I can switch during the night. I usually start on my back and end up on my stomach, and this just works. And never had a problem with it. And it's something to note, because we'll talk about Nemo, inflatable things, in a second. Let's say I had issues with Nemo. But not with that. Well done, Nemo. Let's continue before the mosquitoes eat me alive. This is my underwear. This is a Forclaz by Decathlon Merino Wool underwear. I started out with Smart Wool, another brand of Merino Wool underwear that I really, really like. But the problem is they tend to get too thin where the two thighs meet. As you can see my fingers through it. But the other one was destroyed after 1,000 kilometers, and they are very expensive. So I bought those ones at Decathlon, thinking, they're going to be destroyed as well, but I don't care, they're less expensive. Those have 2,000 kilometers on them, and I didn't clean them every day, that's the least I can say. So they got insanely dirty, but they got the job done all the way. I have no holes, no problems. Absolutely love those underwear, and it's Decathlon. And usually Decathlon has quite a bad reputation in France. It's not like the top hand products. This works better than a top-hand product. My socks, done tough socks, two pairs, one on me, one in the backpack. What can I say? Those are the best freaking socks in the entire universe. They just work. These socks, I have a few holes after 3,000 kilometers, but just a few. And I can't complain about them. They're really, really nice socks. I love those socks. And finally, my first layer slash pyjama. Never used it as a first layer to actually walk on them, but I use it as a pyjama every night. Whatever happens, I was changing into that because I like to be clean before getting to bed. I have the same exact ones since all my hikes. I bought them for the Via Adriatica, I still use them. These are Ortovox first layer in Merino wool. nothing to say but positives. It fits well, it's regulating your temperature, it feels very soft, even if you're insanely dirty and disgusting. It just feels good on the skin. It's just a perfect first layer. In this compression sack, and I know a lot of people hate the concept of compression sacks, I have my quilt. My quilt is the same quilt as my first hike. It's an amazing piece of equipment. It's made by Cumulus again. It's a Cumulus quilt, 450. It has no issue whatsoever. Still kept it soft, kept me super warm as soon as I changed my mattress. We'll get to that for a second. I lost a few feathers, but when I say few feathers, it's like this one, you know? Like I see it and I can grab it usually on the other side and boom, disappears. I mean, this thing is amazing. I don't think I'm gonna change my quilt. I really don't think so. It was perfect, it was good. I like this quilt. The mattress. This is a Thermarest Neo Air Xterm. And this is the ultra big one. We're talking about the maximum pad you can find. Because I like to have a very nice big pad. I like my comfort at night. And this is the pad I had at the beginning of the Pyrenees, but I started with another pad that completely let me down. I started with the Nemo Tensor, Alpine Tensor, that I love when it works. But during the course of my trek, it started to develop leaks at the baffles. And at some point, so many leaks that I was afraid to go to sleep at night because I was afraid I would, again, have a crazy bad night with a mattress deflating every half an hour to 1 hour. And I was patching it constantly and constantly after 7 or 8 leaks. I couldn't take it anymore and I asked Nemo for a change because they're a lifetime warranty. It was kind of hard to have a change on site during my trek, but I managed. So Nemo changed my pack, my mattress. And they even told me, we're going to give you the best one, the longbow version. The longbow version is reinforced, a bit heavier, but the bottom is reinforced. Good thing, the bottom is where I had all my leaks. So they sent me over the reinforced version. Problem is, the reinforced version lasted 30 days. And after 30 days, I had another leak. And the 2 nights after, another leak. And again, another leak. And then the baffle started to explode. And I had a huge bulge on my mattress. I was so fed up with that. And on top of that, I was going through the Pyrenees soon. And I knew that the Pyrenees would be very cold. And this is my protection against the ground. The ground is cold, I don't want to freeze to death in the mountains. I know it can get really, really low, like in the minus temperatures in high altitude, so I need a real mattress. And I decided to make a switch to Thermarest. I ordered this Thermarest Xterm, couldn't be happier. Didn't have a single issue, the thing worked exactly as it's supposed to be. And it's insanely warm. And I'm talking insanely. Before that, I could get a little bit cold with my Alpine and my quilt, and I was making it on the quilt, like the quilt might not be good enough. The moment I switched to this one, this quilt was too warm. This is magical. When you touch it, you feel it's heated. It reflects so much warmth. Yeah, we'll see how long, because I know Thermarest can have issues as well with durability. We'll see how long it goes, but for the moment, I crossed the entire Pyrenees with it and no problem. And I don't even check on the surfaces I put it, because all the leaks I ever had were always faulty baffle welding. And I never had a puncture, ever. Whatever the ground, never had a puncture. I still am careful, but not that much, because it's really hard to puncture those things. And that's it for the backpack. Now, just to finish it off, let's talk about what I was wearing. Let's talk with, I mean, I think one of the most important parts, the shoe. These are the Olympus 4 by Altra that are not so easy to find in France. You have to order them online. These are massive shoes. They are very wide. The toe box is insane. And those shoes, I used 3 pairs to finish the HexaTrek. I should have gone for 4 pairs. I was really pushing it. As you can see, this is the end of the trip and it's already lacking grip. It still has some, but it's lacking a lot. Like the Vibram logo is really destroyed. and you can feel it, especially when you're walking on small rocks. The padding inside is very slim now, and you can feel all the rocks individually, and it starts to hurt. Those shoes work. Those shoes work really well. They are very good shoes. They have a ton of grip. It's really nice. They work on almost every circumstance. The only downside is, because of the wide shoe, they don't fare well in snow. I had tremendous issues with snow. I was falling constantly. I couldn't walk on snow with those. And also on loose gravel, pebbles, really, really bad. Didn't work at all. But everything else you can throw at them, they worked. I crossed the entire HexaTrek with those, getting protected by those gaiters. Those gaiters are the standard Decathlon gaiters. They are, there's nothing to say about them. They're gaiters, they're 15 euros and they prevent anything to get inside, and it's really nice. I really like those gaiters. I didn't want them at first. I picked them up after 800 kilometers and yeah, they make a difference. You don't have to stop and empty your shoes of annoying rocks. Now, the pants. Those pants are Tango World. No fancy pants, those pants are very normal pants. But I love them. I love them because they have five pockets that can zip, which is very nice. And I love them because they are very stretchy. They developed a ton of holes because, well, this is tough terrain. I had to sew a few pockets and stuff like that. One of the zippers doesn't work anymore, but all in all, they survived 3,000 kilometers. The only downside is this color. Because of the color, I looked disgusting every day. Beige. What a stupid idea to go on the trek with mud wearing beige. The first day after any washing, I looked like a hobo. Don't go for beige, guys. Go for a darker color, like my shirt. This is actually the second shirt I had on the trek, and I think the first one was faulty because it cracked really fast several times. I actually love those. Those are Columbia Silver Ridge shirts. They look good. They just look good, and to me, I wear shirts in my everyday life, whatever. I don't own t-shirts, so I could not hike in t-shirts, but having the option to have long or short sleeve is very practical. Having the option to cover yourself from the sun or to get a little bit more warmth is very practical. Having the capacity to do this, to protect your neck from the sun, is really nice as well. And it's very well ventilated. You can open it, you can close it. I just love those shirts. The first one cracked after 1,000 kilometers, a little bit more, 1,500, and it was full of problems, like tiny holes everywhere, huge cracks. It cracked on both shoulders directly. So I think there was a problem with the shirt, because I picked up the exact same in a different color, and this one doesn't have a single issue. And the one I had before on the Via Adriatica didn't have a single issue, and I was going through vegetation like crazy. So I think I had a faulty product before. This one is perfect. Smells a bit bad, but it's fine. In this pocket, I have my shades. Those are Valon sunglasses. Really like those sunglasses. It's, let's be honest, very hipsterish. The size of it, the style of it, this leather thingy. But I picked them up because of the leather thingy on the sides that really prevent the sun from coming in your eye, especially when you are in high altitude and surrounded by rocks or snow. It makes a difference. They also fit very well with those. They don't come out. They're very light. They're very, very nice. The field of view is really bad, extremely bad, but that's the form factor. And they're a little bit expensive. I switched to them midway because I started with another pair, the Senski Treeline. Same, they have the plastic covers on the side to prevent the sun from coming, and I love the Senski Treeline, and I actually have another pair of Senskis, and Senskis, in my opinion, are the best value. They just work flawlessly, they have a lifetime warranty, they're made of recycled plastic, and the lenses are category 3, plus mirrored, those ones as well, but they're way more expensive. I love them, but I lost them, I'm not sure how yet. I know in which village, Le Vivier. You have my glasses. They work really well. I like them. I like the Senski's Treeline as well. Could not really pick a favorite, but the Senski's are a little bit more easy to use, but a little bit harder to store. Those ones are really easy to store, but a little bit finicky to use. but I love them, protecting me really well. In this pocket I have earbuds and a USB-C cord to actually plug to my phone, a little lighter, and this lighter is so cool. I mean, it's a pigeon wearing a beret. Always in my pocket, my knife, always fire, always a knife. Obviously I have an Opinel. This is the most French knife you can imagine. This Opinel has been with me through the HexaTrek. This Opinel has been with me through, my GR10 and through my Pia Adriatica. I mean, this Opinel has been everywhere. This is a fantastic knife because it's lightweight and because it gets the job done. And have to take the carbon version. Don't take the inox, take the carbon. Why? Because the carbon is insanely easy to sharpen. Yes, it can rust, but you will eat so many sausage and cheese that it will leave fat on it, so it will protect it. Because it's so easy to sharpen, you can sharpen it when you stop at any town and you have a coffee. Take your coffee mug and you can sharpen it on the bottom of your coffee mug and you have a razor sharp knife constantly in your pocket. Phone. My phone was insanely important to me. This entire trek is doable because we have a GPS. We don't have the rights yet to mark the entire trail, and it won't be possible before at least 20 years. So you need the GPS all the time with you to know where you're going, even though you're following known trails, so you cannot really get lost. It's just to know when you have to switch trails, and in some other sections that are a little bit more tricky. This is the Pixel 6 Pro. First time I have a fully tactile phone. I used to be a BlackBerry guy, but I picked up this phone because of the battery life, because the crazy quality pictures, and I put this very sturdy protection. Didn't fail me once. This was my GPS, this was my camera, this was my music player, this was my social media thing, this was my professional phone. This thing did everything constantly, did it flawlessly. I really enjoyed this phone. Very nice trek phone. Watch, this is my Seiko 5 that goes with me on every adventure. It's been with me since the beginning. Love the thing, automatic, and it's just nice and gorgeous, and whenever I see it, I'm happy. So yeah, I love this watch. And finally, obviously, the elephant in the room, my beret. I have no words to tell you how much I love this thing. I am a beret man now. This thing is a beret made by Manufacture du Beret in the Béarn. And this beret is the only partnership we had on the entire HexaTrek for the HexaTrek Association. We received 3 berets for the association because we wanted to make a partnership with them, but the woman who was making the beret, because that's handled, single-handedly made by a woman, said she didn't want to have a partnership because it would make her too much business, and she was afraid she could not handle the entire business, and she doesn't want to hire more people. She has one employee. She doesn't want to hire more people because she wants to keep the business small so that the quality remains constant and she is stress-free, and I get that. So we received 3 berets. We didn't have any other partnership, so this beret was for free, and this is my best friend. This is my best friend. This is a beautiful piece of equipment. This is merino wool, French merino wool, handmade. This has been sitting on my head the entire trek. Everybody has asked me, but isn't it too warm? No. I went through so many heat waves, and this was protecting me from the sun. It is a slightly larger brim than a typical beret. This is something I choose on purpose because it keeps the shade everywhere. On top of that, because it's a beret, you can shape it the way you prefer. So if the sun is coming on this angle, you can put it like this. Same if you want to protect your neck on the end of the day, something like that. It's a terrible fit there, but you can do whatever you want with it. You cannot break it. It's indestructible. Whenever it rains, this keeps all the rain out of your face. You're fully protected. Looks good. Love it. I spent a crazy amount of time during the day thinking about my beret. Really. Like, how appreciative I was of my beret. I just love this thing. It's a beautiful piece of equipment. It's handmade. We do not get anything else but those 3 berets. So if you buy a beret, it's on you. I used to hike with a hat, with a cap. It's not good enough. I used to hike with a full brim hat. Not good enough. Leather one. I don't think I will hike with anything else than a beret now. It really protects you from everything. Two things to know. If you are very fast, it will get too warm because it will keep your body warm quite a lot. So if you do something very sportive, it might not be the best fit for you, but if you're just hiking normally, it's perfect. I do not overheat in it. Yeah, it destroys your your hairstyle. I started bald, so it was fine, but after that you look a little bit like a medieval page every time you take it out, so keep it. It can fall off if there is a crazy amount of wind. So just be mindful of that. It's horrible to lose your beret. Kevin actually did lose his beret. So yeah, be mindful of that. But yes, that's it. That's the entire review of what worked, what didn't. Mostly everything worked, really. I don't have a lot of complaints. So I hope you found this useful. I will be working now on a documentary about the trek to go along it. And yeah, I hope you liked what you saw and that it helps you know what you need to cross France through the mountains. Cheers.